Blackstone Audio presents Young Mr. Roosevelt, FDR's Introduction to War, Politics, and Life, by Stanley Weintraub. For Mark and Judith, David and Carrie Lee, Erica and Bruce. Come gather, children, by my side, and listen well to me, how fortune dealt with Roosevelt, the pride of our Navy. Lewis McHenry Howe. 'Tis the curse of the service. Preferment goes by letter and affection, not by the old gradation, where each second stood heir to the first. Othello, General of the Venetian Navy. We cannot anchor our ship of state. We must go forward or flounder. FDR, accepting the Democratic vice presidential nomination, Hyde Park, August 9, 1920. Preface. The Beginnings of Promise. Working on Final Victory, about the wartime 1944 presidential campaign, in which Franklin Delano Roosevelt won an unprecedented fourth term, abbreviated by his sudden death in April 1945, I planned to include a chapter on the service vote. Millions of Americans in uniform at sea or on distant fronts were eligible for absentee ballots. In the first decade of the new century, many former servicemen I contacted, however elderly, recalled where they were and how they voted, by mail, in person, and through helpful questionnaires on my behalf across the country. I recorded their responses. In each case, I asked why the veteran voted for the candidate chosen then. Former sailors and their officers frequently answered, "I voted for Roosevelt because he was a Navy man." A Navy man? Young Roosevelt was, indeed, Assistant Secretary of the Navy during World War I and into 1920. I determined, once the 1944 book was completed, to examine what kind of Navy man he was, and how those wartime years of political apprenticeship foreshadowed his future. The only child of a young mother and a father in late middle age, both wealthy, patrician, and bred on venerable rustic estates long predating the nation's independence, Franklin Delano Roosevelt could look forward to an untroubled future as a country squire. He might interrupt his moneyed leisure with golfing, boating, gentlemen's clubs, cocktails, cards, connoisseurship, and oversight of family properties and investments. Perhaps, too, through an undemanding Ivy League law background, he might endure the occasional preparation of briefs in a prestigious Wall Street firm. An arranged marriage with a well-to-do society beauty also seemed inevitable, and very likely an honorary and unexacting position in politics and public life arranged through lending his Roosevelt signature to corporate letterheads and through his liberality to party funds. After an estimable, blameless, boring passage of years, he would be remembered in a modest obituary in the New York press, but hardly beyond, and then quietly forgotten. None of the above would happen. Owning an inherited fortune and recognizable surname might push someone into unwarranted prominence, then prove poor springboards, as the disappointing successors to famous names have repeatedly demonstrated. Yet exceptions to such handicaps happen. Robert McCormick, implacable publisher of the Chicago Tribune, called FDR scornfully, "one half of 1% Theodore Roosevelt." But Bertie McCormick lived to see his words haunt him. Although vastly overshadowed at first by a flamboyant elder cousin, his wife's Uncle Ted, who had made the White House his bully pulpit, a callow FDR would overcome the mixed blessing of his background. He would explore paths into government, run for political offices, and win and lose, survive a potentially devastating extramarital scandal, come close to death in a pandemic, then prevail over crippling paralysis that left him wheelchair-bound, energize recovery from the greatest economic depression in the nation's history, and oversee its greatest war, and campaign and win four tumultuous terms as president. Supported by documentation beyond lists and names and places and dates, biographers are inevitably prompted by their recognition of how lives turn out. As readers, we possess that delicious sense of dramatic irony that we know not only what the figure at the center, here the young Franklin Delano Roosevelt, could not have known, but how and why what happened did happen. We possess a growing awareness of how unforeseen disasters were averted or surmounted, and how successes were frustrated by hubris or followed up by even further achievement, and how routine associates on the margins of his early experience would turn up later as vital supporting players on a larger stage. Young Franklin's first and unpromising acquaintance with that stage occurred when he was 4 or 5, and his father, already nearly 60, gained entree to the White House, where a president of his own party, whom James Roosevelt had financially supported, sat, burdened with political troubles. "I have one wish for you, little man," said burly Grover Cleveland, "that you will never be president of the United States." When Roosevelt died on December 8, 1900, his only child was 18. A distant cousin, Theodore, from the rival and dominant party, had just been elected vice president. A freshman at Harvard, Franklin had briefly joined the college's Republican Club to promote TR's candidacy. The next year, an assassin's bullet would elevate the elder Roosevelt, who had won with William McKinley, to the presidency. The teenage Roosevelt had hoped to go to the Naval Academy at Annapolis, but James had not wanted Franklin away at sea during his father's declining years. The closest he would get to Annapolis would be as an unseasoned young man on the make, when he would relocate to Washington on a minor peacetime political appointment at the pleasure of another Democratic president he hardly knew, Woodrow Wilson. Despite Franklin's heady dreams, he was hardly confident, except in friendly brag, that he would later return as president himself, defying the sudden and unanticipated burdens of being physically handicapped, that he would live out his greatest years in that relentlessly competitive capital, thwarting what might have been terminal disability and premature retirement. Young Mr. Roosevelt is about how the expectations of an unremarkable patrician future unraveled, and the FDR that we and history remember began to emerge. On October 24, 2012, at the southern tip of Roosevelt Island, in the East River between Manhattan and Queens, a Four Freedoms Park was dedicated as a memorial to President Roosevelt. It is the last completed design of Louis Kahn, one of the most influential architects of the 20th century. He died in 1974, long before his vision took shape. Did he intend, in part, to suggest FDR's beginnings in national office? A pointillist carpet of gray and white granite bricks leads towards the apex, an observer wrote, which parts the waters like the prow of a great ship. Stanley Weintraub, Beech Hill.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.